Welcome back to New Amsterdam Radio, the podcast for thinkers, doers, and creatives. My name is Flobo Boyce, and my guest today just has a fantastic book that we're going to talk about in just a second. Please welcome Joe Mack. Hi, how's it going, sir?
Okay, this is Joe Mack. Hi, thank you for the invitation.
Oh, yeah. So you said before we went live that you're recording from Atlanta. How is Atlanta today?
Oh, there's a great day. The sun's shining and it's in the 60s.
It's about the same here in Los Angeles. It'll probably get warmer, I guess. Okay. Let's talk about your book, The Centurion, the Tale of the Crucifixion. What was the idea behind creating the book in the first place?
I was approaching 90 years old. I had an accounting practice. It was a great joy. It was a social function as well as a business function, but mm-hmm. my eyesight failed or was failing, and I had to give that up. And I do my own yard work, so I had 50 years of neglect in the yard to take care of, but I had time in the mornings and in the late evenings. So I had been writing audit reports for a CPA firm at one time. And it occurred to me that I ought to try to just write a novel. So yeah. One of my clients was a retired creative writing teacher at the University of Tennessee. So she agreed to coach me. So she put me through about a year of boot camp for creative writing. And we ended up with a 700-page novel.
Whoa!
And so she says, now you got to get two editors or get an editor to cut down the novel. So I live in a small town with a local liberal arts college. So among my class was an editor who taught it to college. And so I asked her to edit the book. And so we picked the coach. And we thought the 10 best pages and submitted it to the editor, and she agreed to edit the book.
Yeah.
So she edited the book, and a neighbor and I tried to translate the hieroglyphics into text. And after 2 weeks, we only had about two pages. So I had the editor find another editor local. And she was great. She was younger, and she and I read every line. And if the line didn't enhance the novel or move the novel along, she dropped it out, cut it out. So she cut it down to 350 pages, and we submitted it to one publisher, and he rejected it because of the violence in the book. They did not publish anything with violence in it. And I asked that editor if she knew of anybody that might be interested in it, because she indicated it was the violence that they rejected, not the quality of the book. Mm. And so she submitted it to Archway, and Archway published it. So that's the source of the novel. It represents, I guess, 80 years of Sunday school and my experiences in a lifetime. So it's really a memory dump of my life set in the first century.
Yeah, let's go into it. Set in the first century, swords and sandals and intrigue. Why was it your decision to focus on Cornelius of all the characters of that time period?
Well, out of the Sunday school experience, I wanted to tell my story in another, how do you say that? In another format. So after 80 years of Sunday school, I thought I might have enough competency to do that. And so it is a memory dump of my life, okay, but it's set in the first century.
Yeah, yeah. And fleshing out the other characters, as you come across a character that you've got to know better after writing this book?
Oh yes. In the Gospel of Luke, Luke 10, he talks about Cornelius centurion of the Italian cohort. Well, it occurred to me, I was in the Marine Corps on two different enlistments, that if he referred to Cornelius as a centurion of the Italian cohort, he must have been a George Patton of his day. So I picked Cornelius as my main character and built the story around him.
Oh, very cool. So you said yourself that you were a veteran. Thank you for your service.
I owe you all the debt because I came out of it with a good education. And I came out ahead.
What's been some of the parallels between your experience in the military and what Cornelius goes through in the centurion?
Well, I figured I was on four different campaigns in the Pacific with the 4th Marine Division. And I figured there wasn't much different in my life on a campaign than that of a legionnaire in the 10th Legion. I figured we lived about the same kind of life.
Okay. Did your time at war impact your faith or change your faith at all? Or was it unwavering throughout?
Say that again.
Was your time at war, did it impact your faith at all? Or was it constant throughout?
I didn't get the question. I'm sorry.
So when you're at war, you probably see the worst of the human condition. And you said yourself that you were going to Sunday school for years before you deployed. Did you learn anything about yourself and your relationship with your own faith? Or was it a situation where you had the foundation and the challenges you had when you were at war, which is something that you knew and expected, anticipated?
No, I think I pretty well had the foundation. I got a good education, or I think I got a good education. I majored in business, but I fell in love with the coursework because it's free. So each semester, I could pick all the courses I could take, and it didn't cost anything. So right. I always took one course in philosophy and one course in literature. So that background helped me more than anything else in writing the novel.
As an author, what was your experience actually writing dialogue for Jesus Christ himself?
I'm sorry, say it again.
As an author, what was your experience in writing dialogue as Jesus, for Jesus Christ himself?
Well, the trouble was, in writing audit reports, I didn't have dialogue. So that was a big burden that the creative writing teacher had in teaching me prose, is how to introduce dialogue into text. Mm-hmm. She did a great job on that, I think.
Okay, yeah. Was it interesting? Was it kind of exciting? Looking forward to writing dialogue for these characters? Or was it kind of like, man, I hope I get it right? What was your experience in doing so?
Well, I had, I would write it, and of course, based on, when I read the novel now, I can see sections that read like an audit report. So, the trouble was trying to introduce dialogue into the audit report. And finally, I think it gets better as the book goes on through. I got better toward the end than I was at the beginning.
Yeah. What's been some of the feedback you've heard from people who've read it? Like, they said, hey, look, what I like most about your book was this aspect, this character, this locale, the story.
Well, let's see. Most of the people, the people that gave the best reviews for the most part were veterans. I had a number of Marine friends that read it, and I'm not sure whether they were just trying to please me, but they liked it because it was it had the military in it, and what I would like for people to do, if they would, is read the novel for the story, and then go back and read it again for all the opinion. I'm highly opinionated, and I'm trying to justify a lot of my opinions in the novel. And so if you read it a second time carefully, you'll see where I'm airing an opinion, where I can make a statement without successful contradiction. Okay.
Sure. How do you feel about the recent rise of more Christian literature? Do you think that's we're moving the needle into a place where more and more Christian authors are comfortable with telling stories that speak to them?
Well, I hate to admit it, but I've been reading histories of World War II instead of novels, so I'm not familiar with any of the writings of Christian material.
I'm in the same boat. I prefer nonfiction. Even though I write fiction, I prefer nonfiction. There's nothing wrong with that. So you can get your research. It's okay. In your preface, you mentioned your upbringing in rural North Carolina as, quote, Eden on Earth. And I just want to know how so. How was that? I want to know more about that side of you.
Okay. Let's see. I was raised in the Black Mountains, where Mountain Mitchell is, on a hillside farm. And to me, it was like Eden. If Eden's half that fair, I'll be happy in Eden. Okay. It was absolutely beautiful. It was in the 20s. They were just beginning to log out the great timberlands there. And everybody had plenty of work to do working for the logging company. And my grandmother was a cook for a logging camp. And my mother was raised in a logging camp. So it was a great world.
Oh, great. Great to hear. You know, a lot of our listeners on New Amsterdam Radios are authors or aspiring authors as well. Going through the process of having an idea and writing your novel, do you have any like suggestions or tips or kind of like advice you can give these people?
Oh, so that last part again.
Do you have any tips or suggestions or advice for those who may be listening now and contemplating writing their own novel?
Well, I think the thing I tried to do in mine was to tell an interesting story, and at the same time air my beliefs and trying to convince my reader that it's a great life, that we're endowed with things that cause it to be a great life, and we need to develop our abilities and enjoy this great, beautiful world.
That's great to hear. I'm just curious, what's your writing process like? Do you write daily? Do you take certain days or times of the day to write? Do you write when you're inspired? How do you go about that?
When I was writing the novel, I don't write now. I think about things that maybe I ought to write, but I guess at 96, I'm not sure I have time to finish. But anyway, when I was writing the novel, I had free time in the morning, so I would just sit down every morning and write, and the story just fell in place. I didn't do any research in the traditional meaning of the term, and I didn't have an outline. The first sentence in the book was, "My name is Cornelius, first centurion, first cohort," and then it just fell into place after that, and so I would write the novel in sequence. So I wrote the grandfather's part first. We had trouble structuring the novel. I had trouble with dialogue trying to get the story across. So the author, the coach and myself, we came up with writing each one in the first person so that I could convey what they were thinking, because their outlook was as important as what they said. So everything's in the first person. And once we got that settled down, then the novel just fell in place.
Did I hear this correctly, that there's going to be no sequel? That's it, the one and done?
Well, I would be great if I could write a sequel. And I think about that. I've got another story in mind that I think would make a great story, but I've got discipline myself to get it done. But we'll see about that.
Well, yeah, we'll see about that. And I'm sure people listening now can pick up a copy of the book, The Centurion, A Tale of the Crucifixion, available now, or your favorite e-tailer. If Joe, does anyone want to connect with you, follow you online, ask you a question, how to go about doing that?
Say that again.
If anyone's listening now and they want to connect with you online or to follow you on social media or to send you an email, how to go about doing that?
I have, by the way, there are a number of reviews of the novel on the internet. So type in my name and let's see, type in my name and I think put interviews after it. So there are interviews and comments on the internet. And if they want to get in touch with me, let's see. Let me give you my regular email, and if that gets to be a problem, I'll get a new email. my email is jomchigh@hotmail.com, jomchigh@hotmail.com. And I'll look forward to receiving an inquiry, and I'll try to get an answer.
Good to hear. Thanks so much for being on the show on this edition of New Amsterdam Radio.
Okay, thank you. It's been a real pleasure.